Lots of calls on deck. Stephen in Vancouver, what's your question?
Gentlemen, thank you for taking my question. Your show has been very informative. And Mr. Burrows, if I may impose on your natural tendency to be educational as well, because you seem to explain all the specific terms that you spoke about on the show. My question is on the price to book. You just explained it a few minutes ago. But what does it tell us, the price to book ratio? And then when you also mentioned about the price to earnings, yes, I understand that a little bit, because it means that how much investors are willing to pay for the earnings of the company.
Yes.
Is that EBITDA, the earnings, or is it a net profit after the income tax and the depreciation?
Right.
Thank you, sir. And I hang up.
Over to Professor Burrows.
So, Stephen, there's lots of metrics that we look at when we look at businesses. And some things point to how much you're paying for the earnings, the multiple of earnings, PE. PE is tricky for some people because they look at what their expectation is for earnings and they divide price by those earnings and they get a PE. So lots of people right now say stock market's expensive because the PE is high. And it turns out this quarter that 78% of companies beat the estimate. So maybe the estimate was too low.
Yeah.
So maybe the PE isn't as high as people think. So in a period of time when estimates are going higher, you have to take that into account. So we look at that. And, you know, the Canadian banks are a little more expensive than the U.S. banks right now. But we do look at the growth rate of earnings and why that might be. You know, for instance, in the case of TD, which trades at 15 times earnings, they're growing their U.S. business at 26%. That's kind of attractive. So you pay a higher multiple for that. But you also look at the value you're paying for the assets in the event that there was a problem. And that's the price to book value that you're looking at. And so when I look at these U.S. banks trading at 1 to 1.5 times their book value, I say I'm not paying that much for the assets that I'm getting, and I'm not taking that much risk because they're pretty scrutinized on the value of those assets in the world we live in today. So you want to look at both. And then importantly, is the right group the right group? And financials are doing well. The percent of financials doing well has been expanding, meaning more and more are doing well. And then you look at the individual companies and price, is price doing what it should be doing given the what we think we know fundamentally, and all those things are important.
Okay, we got Tyler in Calgary on the line. What's your question?
Yes, how are you doing today? My question is I've been following Baytech for quite some time and actually invested in them, and I was just kind of curious what your long-term thoughts on it. I seen the stock, you know, dip down below $3 when oil was at $42 a barrel about 6 months ago. And, you know, it rebounded a bit, 20%, and then back down when oil was at 50. And then, you know, oil gets up to $57 a barrel, and it shot up again, but it's still trading at only 20% higher than it was when oil was $42 a barrel. So I'm just wondering, but it's slightly uptrending. So I'm just wondering what your thoughts are with this company in the next year, and if you see any value in it long term as well.
Sure. Okay, so Tyler, energy is a tough one right now. When energy rolled over in 2014, you had a 66% decline at $26 a barrel, oil reversed, and you had a one-year rally, which was actually quite similar to what happens after a bubble bursts. You get a 12 or 14-month bounce. The difficulty is that the oil industry's changed in that when the price goes up, production can come on pretty quickly today with fracking. And so I've said now for a couple of years, you should look at these as trades, not some structural long-term bull market. It's unlikely we're going to get a big long run-up in price, in my view. And so I think if you're going to invest in an oil stock, you want to buy one that's been able to get better while everybody else has been struggling. And so I'd use the example of a Suncor or a CNQ that have been able to buy assets cheaply as you've gone through this period. I think most of the more conventional producers are having a tougher time. So look, technically, the 150-day moving average on Baytech is falling. Yes, it's trying to put a bottom in. But again, I go back to this issue around, you know, the fact we are in a very strong market and these companies are underperforming. So you own the stock. It's now trading above the 150-day moving average or about the 150-day moving average. I would really pick a point below the price it's trading at now. Maybe that's below the 50-day moving average at 350 and use that as a stop loss and see if something can develop from here. I wouldn't commit new money to it.
Okay, that was Baytex. We got Paul in St. Thomas, Ontario. What's your question?
Thank you, Greg. My question to your guest is about Keyera. And I wondered if the Kinder Morgan pipeline, if it's successful, or shipping gas to Asia would be beneficial to this company.
Right.
Thank you.
Paul, I think you're dealing with a structural macro problem for the energy infrastructure companies right now. So we look at Keyera and you see it's trading near the lows and you think, what's wrong with Keyera? It's really the whole group. And, you know, from 2009 through 2014, prices rose for oil, volumes grew dramatically, dividends grew dramatically, and the energy infrastructure companies went from trading at six times their earnings as boring bond-like vehicles to trading at 24 times earnings as Canada's greatest growth stocks. And then the bubble burst. And so I think that the stocks right now are reflecting the fact that growth will not necessarily be there. And so the multiple is contracting again, as you would if you're not as comfortable with growth in the future. If you look at any MLP or pipeline in the U.S., they're really performing poorly. And almost all the ones in Canada are performing poorly. So I don't know when that's going to change. The one of the bunch that's trading, you know, the best is Pembina. So if you had to own one, I'd probably own that one. But I just want to be a little careful with this group. I don't think it should be a big weight in a portfolio. We're in a world where money is leaving the bond proxies, things that act like bonds, utilities, telcos, REITs, consumer staples, to things that are more economically sensitive, like industrials, technology, you know, consumer cyclical, and so on. And so this doesn't fall into that category. I don't think it's very timely.
Okay. We're going to be back with David Burrows, President and Chief Investment Strategist at Barometer Capital Management. Wants to answer your questions on North American large caps, give us a call. Toll free, 1-855-326-6266.